I'm Emma Kane, Chief Executive of Newgate Communications, and I'm delighted to be joined by someone who knows a thing or two about managing difficult and complex situations. Many will remember him as Britain's most senior police officer. For 7 years, from 2011 to 2017, Lord Bernard Hogan-Howe led London's Metropolitan Police Service. Widely considered to be the toughest job in the public sector, the Met Commissioner faces constant scrutiny from the politicians, the media, and the public. We'll be hearing Lord Hogan-Howe's insights and advice on how to steer a large organisation through some of the most difficult and sensitive issues. First, though, a little bit of history. He began his career 41 years ago. Spotted as a high flyer with South Yorkshire Police, he quickly rose through the ranks and was selected not only to study law at Oxford, but criminology at Cambridge and later an MBA at the University of Sheffield, the city where he was born and grew up. Lord Hogan-Howe, welcome to Newgate Communications webinar in partnership with Rosenblatt Solicitors, the city law firm that you're a special advisor to. We're going to be talking about leadership, crisis management and security, three very pertinent topics at any time, but particularly through the lens of COVID-19. So you've had a long career in public service. What sticks in your mind as the most difficult challenge as a leader, and what did you learn?
Well, first of all, good afternoon, Emma, and thanks for the invitation. I think there's been a few things. I used to also be chief constable in Merseyside, and we had two or three big issues there. One was about the amount of firearms crime, and we had to get it down. And within that, we had the murder of a young boy, Rhys Jones, only 11 years old, a terrible event. And we all felt very personally that this was an obvious crisis, and we had to do to make sure one, it didn't happen again, and we had to catch the killer. And then in the Met, every day almost seemed a crisis. It's a huge city, nearly 9 million people, a world city by any standards. We led the counter-terrorist policing effort across the United Kingdom, and we're constantly working with government to try and get things better, but also with the mayor. And trying to ride those two horses at times could be quite a challenge. During my time in the Met, then we got the tail end of the riots. We had the riots of 2011, and we had to make sure they didn't happen again. Mm. We also had to do that while preparing for the Olympics. And then, as I took over the job, someone mentioned we're about to lose £600 million from our £3.6 billion budget. So I take together, there was quite a few things that you were trying to herd to make sure it happened in the right direction, but every day something happened which wasn't quite within the plan.
And when going gets really tough, what advice would you give to business leaders on how to help support their people?
Well, I think the first thing is, this sounds a bit contradictory, but I think you've got to be a little bit selfish, and you've got to be very selfless. So the selfish bit sounds odd, but I will mention it first because I think it's vitally important that when you're in a crisis, obviously the leaders have to be fresh, energetic, positive, and making sure that they don't go down when things get difficult. What that means, therefore, is that you have to look after yourself a bit and get your team around you and your family to help you with that. Making sure that you planned in days off, even when you've got a crisis running, is vitally important. Making sure you planned your diary well. One of the things I always do, even in a crisis, was to give my diary to my BA, and they were told that they could have it. But if they wanted to book outside, say 9 to 5, then they had to talk to me about it. Because otherwise you could be wall-to-wall meetings, not actually doing any thinking. And I think one of the vital things in a crisis is you've got to be reflective. You've got to work out not only today's problem, but you've got to start thinking what happens on day two, day five, month two. And you're paid to do that thinking. And I think if you're getting too close to stuff, then that can be quite a challenge. So that's the selfish bit, how you manage to... invest a little in yourself. Hopefully you've arrived fit and you've arrived prepared. But I think during a crisis at a particular time, you've got to think about that. The selfless bit, I think, is to offer your people a good structure. One of the things we did in the police, we had a gold, silver, bronze system of command. Not everyone will operate the same one, but for us, that was gold, was strategic. They set the policies, made sure the resources were in place, started to think 1 to 3 months, perhaps a year, 3 years ahead sometimes. Secondly, then you had the silver commanders, who were the on-the-ground leaders. So when we had Notting Hill Carnival, we deployed about 7,000 police officers. but we had one silver commander at the event who tried to pull all this together. And then below them, they would have the bronze commanders, and they would be literally on the ground, managing sometimes 100 people, sometimes 300 people, and making sure that this thing was working, keeping an eye on what was happening, the day-to-day managers, if you like. So I suppose the question for other organisations, what's your leadership model? Will it sustain you through a crisis, or is it sustain you through normal management of production or providing a service? How do you adapt your model? I think within that, we found it vitally important that when we had a crisis running, we had a rhythm of meetings. So we'd always meet early morning. You can call it morning prayers or briefing, whatever you call it. But we'd meet every morning. We'd then meet again at the end of the day, and that could vary. It could be 5, 6, 8, 10 o'clock in the evening. In between, other people had to go off and do their, what they had to do. But we had an hourly update so that, there was a storyboard so that anybody at any time could pick that storyboard up and say, right, this is what's happening now in this incident. And I think it's vitally important you work with the facts. And certainly my experience has been that at the beginning of a crisis, the facts are never what you were told immediately.
Absolutely.
You get an account and everybody wants to be really positive and tell you that they know exactly what's happening. I'm afraid my experience is that people don't always know what's happening. And the worst thing is they try and fill the gaps. So I think you have to understand that. And you have to just keep asking questions. And until you're sure, then don't really believe you know the facts until you do a bit of checking and got others to check for you. Because it's a natural tendency for anybody who reports to you to want to be a confident, in control. And of course, this is totally within their grasp. I'm afraid most crises aren't at the beginning.
And I think that's one of the surprising things, actually, that you learn it with time and experience, that thing about the first information you get is not always the right information. So, how you go about building that knowledge of what's going across the organisation, I think, is really
important. And I think for me, one of the things that's really helped in the past has been that, one, the police, but other people can have this, we have a staff officer role. So it's usually a police officer of middling rank who's going to go and do great things in the future. So they're really able people. And if you empower them to say, right, go out and find out what's happened. Mm-hmm. Give me the truth. Don't give me what people want me to know. So, they'll ring up. They'll go and visit your team and say, well, what actually happened, not what do you want to believe happened. That's vitally important that you get that. Because if people are able to say, look, I don't know. I've never criticised anybody for saying I don't know. You don't want somebody to always be saying, I don't know. It's perfectly okay, particularly at the beginning of something, say, look, I just don't know this at the moment. We'll find out, or we're going to do some more work. That's okay. But I think filling in the gaps is not helpful. I think the other thing is you've got a good deputy. If you've got somebody who, fills your gaps. We all have blind spots. There are things we're really good at. And then there's some things that we really just miss. We just don't even register that maybe growing in. I think if a deputy or somebody who works alongside you of probably similar peer status, who's able to pull you one side and say, look, you're going down the wrong line here. Or, people just don't understand what you're saying, or they don't understand why you're asking this. Getting worried. You need that feedback constantly, particularly during a crisis. I think when you're running things normally, you can take a little time about that. Somebody comes in to see you next Monday, has a coffee, and you say, well, you need to think about it. In a crisis, you don't have the benefit of time quite often. So I think if you've got just colleagues alongside, it can make a real difference.
But I think would you agree, people need the time to actually, and space to find out the information rather than being under pressure to come up with that answer immediately. And I think, particularly in the corporate environment, sometimes there's a to have an immediate answer and issue a statement, for example, before they really have done the digging. So.
Yeah, and I'd always urge people to get to the point. I helped a company after I left the police with a cyber attack they'd endured. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, I ended up sitting down for about an hour with the head of IT, who was a global head of IT. And his story changed a little during the time that we were talking about it. And he wasn't lying. He wasn't trying to be inaccurate. It was just that they didn't actually know some of the critical details. But they were in the process of making statements, which could have had effect on shareholder value, reputation. Yeah. So I think, it's better to just try your best to be certain about the things you're certain about, but as you say, just give time. I have to admit, though, there is a huge pressure at the beginning because everybody wants to know. When we were dealing with terrorist incidents in perhaps you remember there were terrorist incidents in Paris in 2015.
Absolutely.
The Charlie Hebdo attacks and the Bacalan Theatre attacks. Mm-hmm. We just want to know straight away what happened. So you can imagine, we get on to our officers who are based in the UK Embassy of Paris. We want to know what happened. Just imagine how many embassies are doing that in Paris. And when something happened in London, imagine there's, I think it's over 200 legations in London. So they want to know what happened. You know, did these people have phones? Was there anything? You know, all these sort of operational questions. People need immediate information. So the natural tendency to want it quickly and want it right. But my belief is always that it's better to have it right than have it too quickly.